What's up, Guardians? Profane here. Thanks for checking out the video. Today we're diving into the grasp of Avarice, an extremely fun and adventurous thrill ride through a pirate-themed dungeon that brings Guardians back to the roots of Destiny 1, with returning weapons like the Ice Luna and Thousand Yard Stare, with the crowning gem of the loot being the Gjallarhorn Exotic Rocket Launcher. Today, I'll be covering how any Guardian can easily solo this dungeon in Destiny 2 Lightfall. I have covered how solo Guardians can complete this dungeon in the past, utilizing a Warlock with the old build crafting systems. But today, we'll be using the new Lightfall mods and build crafting system, along with a Hunter. I think most would agree that Warlocks and Titans have had an advantage towards soloing a lot of content in Destiny 2. Which is exactly why we're going with a Hunter in today's video. During some of the encounters, we will be using the new Strand builds, but for the most part, I've found it more beneficial to go with either a Void build or a Stasis build. The Winterbite, the Lament, or the Grand Overture would be my recommendations for best DPS weapons. A Solar Hunter with Blade Barrage and Star Eaters can be equally effective when it comes to the boss encounters. When the Grasp of Avarice begins, you'll be in the Skywatch of the Cosmodrome. Once moving forward, you'll see the Hive and Fallen battling at the infamous Loot Cave. You'll need to defeat the never-ending waves of Hive to collect 60 total Ingrams. These look at first like exotic Ingrams, but they're far from the same. These Ingrams are a reoccurring mechanic throughout this dungeon, and they have an expiration before exploding. You'll see them turn red before they explode. You'll need to collect 60 Ingrams and return them to the crystal within the cave. When collecting an Ingram, you will receive the Burdened by Riches debuff, which will kill you if the time runs out. This will be the same in later encounters. The timer gets refreshed when you collect a new Ingram, and it's imperative that when you deposit your Ingrams at any crystal, that you wait until all have been deposited. Otherwise, you'll run the risk of an untimely death, which will put a big dampener on a solo flawless run. Once you have deposited your 60 Ingrams, the floor will open up, and you can begin your descent into the first jumping puzzle. While this isn't an overly difficult jumping puzzle, it does require you to open specific doorways, using specific triggers, allowing you to progress forward. But scattered throughout are these enemies, or traps, so you'll need to watch out. Eventually, you'll get to a silo, with narrow walkways and hive wizards. You'll have to continue opening doorways to gain access to different triggers that open other doorways. Eventually, you'll get to a silo with narrow walkways and hive wizards. You'll have to continue opening doorways to gain access to different triggers that open other doorways that will eventually lead you to a vandal carrying a scorch cannon. This is another reoccurring mechanic throughout this dungeon. You will use these scorch cannons to shoot generators that either open doors or activate other mechanics throughout each encounter. You will also find your first hidden chest while inside this silo. Once you have activated the generator, to open the door, be sure to watch out for the barrel trap at the top of the steps. Make your way through some air ducts, and you'll find yourself facing the first boss encounter of this dungeon. I always butcher these names, so we're just going to go with what Bungie's new name for this ogre is, which is the Ravenous Ogre. This dude's pretty tanky, and to damage him, you'll need to collect 25 of those Ingrams and return them to the center crystal. This is accomplished by stealing the Scorch Cannon from the Vandal, then opening the doors on the left and right sides of the arena. Inside these rooms are Hive, who will drop the Ingrams. As you collect Ingrams, every 10 will refund all of your abilities and your super, which can become very beneficial in this encounter to save yourself on ammo. I recommend taking the Scorch Cannon with you as you move between the rooms. This way, it doesn't despawn. I typically try to hit up both rooms before depositing, but if you're running out of time, you'll want to hit up the crystal in between each room. After you've deposited 25, you'll have about 30 seconds to dish out damage against the boss. During this damage phase, he will continuously fire his Void Blast, so Void Resistance mods will be needed, as will Concussive Dampener mods, because he has an outlandishly powerful stomp. In all likelihood, you'll have 3-4 damage phases before downing the boss. Heavy Ammo Finder and Scavenger mods will be very beneficial, since you'll likely expend all of your ammo on each damage phase. After each damage phase, you'll need to go and steal the Scorch Cannon from the newly spawned in Vandal. then rinse and repeat until done. After defeating the ogre, you'll head towards the Shroud, where it's time to jump on your Sparrow. The always-on-time Exotic Sparrow will be your best bet towards getting this on the first attempt. You'll need to get to each capture zone before the timer runs out, which can be easier said than done, with a shit ton of Fallen shooting at you. There are a ton of triggers scattered throughout that will extend your time, but don't go out of your way to get each and every one. You should only need about 3 to 4 extra time switches. If your Sparrow starts taking damage, you'll want to hop off and resummon it before it explodes. A Sparrow with reduced summoning time will be beneficial if you're not using Always on Time. The final stretch of this time trial will launch you through a giant skull, where you'll hit up the last capture point with your second hidden chest tucked away in the left side eyehole of the skull. And now it's time to make your way down the crystallized throat of this skull and get to the next encounter, where you'll need to destroy the Fallen barrier that's in the ceiling. This is a really cool encounter, but it's dangerous because there's so much water and you'll have to use these launch pads to shoot your way from island to island. Your goal is to locate 4 servitors that are placed on different islands. Only one will be active at a time. These servitors will first be shielded, so you'll need to defeat the Fallen that spawn in after to collect Ingrams. You will need 20 Ingrams deposited at the crystal to break the servitor shield. The servitors will become bombs after being defeated. Once becoming a bomb, you'll need to push them to the launch pads and shoot them into the 4 shield generators on the ceiling. If a bomb does happen to fall off or miss, or have its timer run out, a new servitor will spawn in at a different location. After all four generators are broken, the shield will go down, and you will need to use the center launch pad to shoot yourself straight up to the top. This can be a bad spot for death, so watch out as you get launched. And now you're on to the final boss, Captain Averick the Covetous. This is a large, fallen captain, and he won't be alone. At his side will be a mini-boss level Vandal and a Shank that will respawn after each damage phase. The Shank, in my opinion, is the worst of the two. With that being said, a Sniper Resistance mod will do great here, because most of your damage taken will be from beyond 40 meters. With the exception of when you deposit Ingrams. And for that, I highly recommend Arc and Solar Resistance mods. There are several platforms scattered across the room, along with the captain's inner platform, and a small grassy patch with death lurking waters. You'll need to collect 60 Ingrams to break the boss's shield. Ingrams will drop from buckets across the walls. Two buckets will drop per side. Each bucket will drop 5. To activate the buckets, you need to find the Vandal using a Scorch Cannon. Steal the Scorch Cannon and locate the 3 generators that are circling the captain's inner platform. After shooting a generator and holding the charge, the buckets will activate and open. You cannot activate the same generator twice in a row, so I find it best to stick to the far right of the arena and bounce between that side and the grassy patch. It's best to stay towards the innermost part of the grassy area so you don't touch the water. If an Ingram or Heavy slides down to it, so be it. Don't lose your life for something like that. Before you begin triggering the buckets though, there's things you need to do first, like take out the Shank. Otherwise, he'll snipe you the whole time and will terrorize you during boss damage. The Vandal isn't as much of a worry at first, but he can pose a threat when depositing at the crystal. The Shank can be whittled away with by using the Scorch Cannon, so try not to waste too much heavy when you could have just as easily used a combination of special and primary along with the Scorch Cannon. You can also freely use your super here, as you regain it after every 10 Ingrams, so don't be afraid to use it to clear out enemies as you collect Ingrams. After collecting the 60 Ingrams, you'll need to covertly deposit them into the crystal on the boss's platform. If you start running out of time though, banking in batches is all the same. After enough crystals are deposited, the boss will teleport to the front of his platform. His shield will burst, and he will be vulnerable for you to go to town on. I don't recommend staying at the crystal though, unless you're a warlock or a titan using a bubble or what. I find it best to jump behind the boss, behind Wilhelm's casket, and deal out damage from there. Just watch out as the boss can stomp you and force push you back. Wilhelm's casket can make a good source for cover to get to in a pinch, allowing you to more easily get away after damage phase is over. Since this is a dungeon, this boss won't enrage, but you don't want to spend an hour in here either. This is why I found it best to run a stasis build, using the Renewal Grasp, providing me resistance and a reduction to enemy damage, while utilizing the insane damage output of the Lament. As I said earlier, Solar Hunters with Star Eaters can really eat away at the boss's damage bar, and right now the Winter Bite really packs a punch. A Strand build with Assassin's Cowl can definitely get you through this dungeon, but I found that after the nerf to super damage, it didn't feel nearly as strong. But if you find a better Strand build that gets you through this dungeon, then be sure to let us know down in the comments below. With that being said, I'm going to let the remainder of this boss fight play out. If you are going through this dungeon to get the Gjallarhorn will drop after the boss is defeated once you loot Wilhelm in the casket. I hope you enjoyed today's video, and I hope this video has been helpful towards your efforts at attempting and completing the Grasp of Avarice dungeon as a solo guardian. Thank you as always for checking out today's video. If you enjoyed and found it helpful, then be sure to hit that like button below, along with the subscribe button if you're new. Both are greatly appreciated, and both really do help support the channel. And until next time, Guardians, this has been Profane, wishing you all some happy hunting.
Thank you.